If you're working with switch mode power supplies, you're likely trying to improve efficiency, increase power density and reliability, comply with EMC regulations, improve power rail integrity, and decrease thermals. This is a lot to think about, and all this design optimization can increase test time. Learn how to easily test your switch mode power supplies and save time in the lab. Hi, I'm Melissa at Keysight Technologies, and in this video, you'll learn how to test your switch mode power supplies with an oscilloscope. The primary purpose of a power supply is to efficiently produce well-regulated and low-noise DC power from an input power rail. Depending on the part of the design you're working on, you might be looking at the switch mode power supply holistically, or only be concerned about one portion of the power supply, the input, the switching, or the output. The input side converts and filters your input voltage. That's typically an AC line voltage of 110 volts in the US or 220 in other regions. If you're primarily concerned with the input side of your supply, you'll likely be focused on power quality, current harmonics, and inrush current. After the input, your signal goes into the main part of the supply, which is the switching transistor. This regulates the voltage with the duty cycle or the amount of time it's on versus off. If this is the part of the power supply you're focused on, you'll be concerned about power losses, modulation analysis, slew rate, and safe operating area. After the switching transistor, the signal gets filtered again and rectified so you get a stepped DC output, which is then used to run power through the rest of your device. If you're focused on the output side of the power supply, you'll want to focus on output ripple, turn on and turn off time, transient response, power supply rejection ratio, and efficiency. An oscilloscope is the most common tool for making power supply measurements, since you can hook up both a voltage probe and a current probe to calculate power, which, as you know, is voltage times current. Another reason why oscilloscopes are a great tool for characterizing power supplies are the analysis applications that can run on them, making testing much more efficient. Let's set up some tests so you can see how some of these measurements are made. If you have an InfiniVision oscilloscope and want to follow along with the steps, you can download a free trial of the power application with the link on screen or in the description. First, let's start by looking at power quality. I'll clear any existing settings from previous tests by selecting default setup. Then I'll press analyze and select the power application. You can now see the full list of the power applications supported by the InfiniVision power application bundle. I have a differential probe on the input side of my power supply, and I connected that to channel 1. I also have a current probe on the input side of my power supply hooked up in the direction of current flow, and that's on channel 2. Since we'll calculate power from our current and voltage measurements, I'll double check that my channels are assigned on the scope to match this. I choose the signals menu, and the default on the scope is that channel 1 is voltage and channel 2 is current. There's also this handy diagram that pops up to show you where to probe your power supply for this test. I'm also going to look at 5 cycles. Now I can simply select auto setup. Since I'm using a power application, the scope automatically scales the signal properly to take advantage of the full bits on the oscilloscope for accurate measurements and sets up the waveform math. In this case, of course, it's V times I to get instantaneous power. Real power is the mean or average power of N cycles. That's the value you're measuring directly. The application will also calculate the other power parameters, such as apparent power, which is voltage RMS times current RMS over a number of cycles. The reactive power is computed by the square root of the apparent power squared minus the real power squared. Power factor is real power over apparent power, and the phase angle is the inverse cosine of the power factor or real power over apparent power. We can dive into the details of power quality results here by pressing apply. So the primary advantage of having an automated power measurement application is that these are all calculated for you with the press of a button. You don't waste time working out the math with pencil and paper or having to extract the voltage and current measurement results to calculate power quality on a separate computer. Another important characteristic to look at on your input line is the current harmonics. In a switch mode power supply, your current is pulsed, which can inject harmonics back into the mains, which can disturb other devices on your power network. If your customer plugs your device into their power outlet at home, you don't want the harmonics disrupting the performance of something else they have running on the same source, like their lights or TV. To prevent this, IEC has specifications that you'll have to pass up to the 40th harmonic to make sure you won't be causing disruption. To test, I turn on the current harmonics measurement. We haven't changed our probe setup, but if this was the first test you were setting up, you could adjust those with the signal menus as before. In the settings, I can choose the frequency of the signal and the IEC standard that I need to test to. My design is qualified as a Class A. Now I'll hit apply to begin the current harmonics measurement. The scope performs an FFT on the current waveform, and the results are listed in the top of the screen. It also measures total harmonic distortion and tells me if I've passed or failed the test. To show you an example of what happens when we fail, I'll change the standard that I have to comply with. Now you can see where the design would not pass these regulations and by what margin. Let's switch modes and look at the switching portion of the supply. You'll lose energy primarily during the switching phases of the transistor when it turns on and off, and during the conduction phase when the voltage is at the transistor's saturated minimum and current flows. To check if the losses are acceptable, I'll choose the switching loss measurement. I also have to change my probe setup to probe on the switching portion of my power supply. When I run the application, we can see two switching cycles on the top view and a zoomed-in view of one cycle on the bottom view. We also get all the power loss measurements displayed automatically. You can zoom in and look at each phase, the conduction, the switching, and the non-conduction phase. The purple waveform is the instantaneous power. Let's look at one more measurement, slew rate. This determines how fast your device turns on and off. The faster you can turn on and off, the lower losses you'll have. We'll follow similar setup steps as before. The purple trace is the derivative of your voltage over time, so the peak of this is the maximum slew rate. In addition to the measurements I covered today, you can also use the InfiniVision Power application to test inrush current, effective resistance of your switching transistor, modulation, and output ripple. Output ripple or power rail integrity measurements are particularly important if you're driving a high-speed digital device. The noise on the power rail could cause jitter and timing uncertainty and affect the validity of your digital signal transmission. You can also measure transient response, efficiency, power supply rejection ratio, and control loop response. You can use these measurements to quantify and optimize your designs on the input side, your switching, and the output side of your supply. If you want to learn more about measuring switch mode power supplies, check out the links in the description and download a free trial of the application to try it out. Don't forget to follow us on Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube for more how-to videos. Thanks for watching.